Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear friends, the text for this morning's sermon is a portion of the gospel lesson from Luke chapter 21. Under the theme this morning, our Lord Jesus is coming again. You may be seated. My dear fellow brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, President Reagan once told the story of a little 12-year-old girl who woke up on her birthday. She dressed as quickly as she could, and she ran to the barn, hoping that her parents had bought for her that little pony that she wanted for her birthday. When she got to the stall, she opened the stall, and it was still a little dark and a little foggy, and she didn't see the pony at all. All she could see was a couple of piles of manure. The little girl said, "Well, with all this manure in here, there must be a pony in there somewhere." Now that Christmas season has begun, maybe you feel a little bit like I do. In spite of all the manure out there, there must be a Christ child in here somewhere. You see, my friends, Christmas is about Jesus. It's not about all the other stuff that you see in the world today. Today, the first day of Advent, the first Sunday of Advent, is the church's New Year. Therefore, Happy New Year! Yes, it's a time of anxious expectation. Expectation of the birth of a little baby boy. And that's why the stable came in by itself this morning. It's to give us a sense of expectation. We know who will be in the stable soon, but they're not quite there yet. It's the expectation of a birth of the God-man as a baby, who is returning in all glory at His second advent. It's also a time of the church that because of these expectations, there's also a sense of repentance and a sense of renewal. Jesus says this morning, "There will be signs in the sun, moon, and stars. On the earth, nations will be in anguish and perplexity at the roaring of the sea and tossing of the sea. Men will faint from terror, apprehensive as what is coming on the world. For the heavenly bodies will be shaken." Isn't it true that we now see many signs of Jesus' first return? Flashing lights, decorated trees, radio stations playing music that you only hear one time of a year. And then there's that little fat man with a red suit and a long white beard. But obviously yet, Jesus is still totally ignored. And also ignored are the signs of His second coming. Not long ago, we were awestruck by the power of a Category 1 hurricane on the East Coast. I know the news media likes calling it a superstorm. It was a hurricane. Lives were lost and lives were uprooted. Homes and businesses were destroyed. And many realized how powerless they really are against the power of nature. Not to mention the power of the one who created nature. The signs of His second coming, my friends, are here. You can ignore them all you want. But if you ignore a high water sign, especially over here on Harner Road, you're in danger of losing your life. It almost happened a couple of years ago. And it is also very dangerous to ignore the signs of the coming of your Lord, His second advent. At that time, they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. In order for us to understand what His return means, we need to understand who Jesus is. He Himself says that He is going to return in a cloud. Sound familiar? Israel was led out of Egypt with a cloud. They were led through the wilderness by God in a cloud. Jesus was transfigured on the top of the mount in a cloud. Jesus ascended into a cloud. And as the angels stood next to the men gawking into the sky, they told them that this same Jesus will return in the very same way, in a cloud. Because this Jesus, who is coming back as the same Lord who freed Israel and led them to the promised land, this same Jesus, this same Lord, who also conquered death and sin by dying on the cross and rising on the third day for you. And this same Jesus, this same Lord, who created the heavens and the earth, will also destroy the earth and the heavens. And then He will come in great glory in a cloud to lead each of you into His promised land, the land that He has promised each of you, His heavenly kingdom. When these things take place, stand up and lift up your heads, because your redemption is at hand. My dear friends, when the day comes, and yes, it will come, you have nothing to fear. Oh, no doubt, some will have everything to fear. Those who have turned from God and pursued their own salvation. Those who have turned from God and pursued the ways of the world. Those who willingly follow the evil one instead of following their Savior. My dear brothers and sisters, do you really have anything to fear of the last day? Does the thought of Jesus returning in great glory and power cause you to tremble in fear? If you really believe that He is returning, are you horrified? No, you have nothing to fear. Because at Jesus' glorious second advent, and because of the cross, you have no fear. For you know that here at the cross, your sins were taken away. And that you can stand before the Son of Man, and that because of Him you are justified, and because of Him you will enter into His kingdom, prepared for each of you before the foundation of the world. Jesus then told them this parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. When they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves. And know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Fig trees were prominent and still are very prominent in Israel even today. Jesus says, all you have to do is look at the signs. You see the trees budding and beginning to leaf, you know summer is near. Look at the signs that He gives us in the text today. When you see these signs happening, you know that your redemption is near. It reminds me of the old nursery rhyme, Peter and the Wolf. You all remember it, so I shouldn't have to tell it. But we know what Peter did. Finally, people stopped believing him. Well, in the church, we will keep telling this story because it is true. I am not a Peter crying wolf. I am a pastor proclaiming to you the truth that your Savior will come again. Jesus Himself says it. I tell you the truth. This generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. People are always very confused about what Jesus was talking about here. What does he mean by this generation? He clearly wasn't talking about the apostles in the first century generation. If he would have meant them, well, Jesus would have been wrong, and Jesus is God. He doesn't make mistakes like that. Some think that he was referring only to the Jews, but Scripture doesn't even refer to that. The key to understanding of what Jesus is talking about when he mentions this generation is this. Luke uses this phrase 9 times. And every time Luke uses this term, this generation, he is speaking of a generation of evil people. Jesus is saying that there will be evil people, even up to the time when he returns. So we are to be aware, my friends, of the evil that surrounds us. I don't think I have to read to you a long list of evils in the world today. All you really have to do is pick up a newspaper or watch the news. You see it for yourself. But that doesn't mean that we are to ignore or to be lax with evil. We are not to treat the devil like he's no big deal. That's exactly what he wants. And we must never, ever act as though God can do nothing about evil. My dear friends, God has already done something about evil here at the cross. And as a matter of fact, he did something about evil at the manger and also the tomb, which is still empty. Yes, heaven and earth will pass away, and so it will happen because Jesus said it. Oh, you may ignore it and believe it and not believe it, but if you ignore and disbelieve a fire alarm, the fire won't cease to exist, or you can't avoid a fire just because you don't believe it. So if you choose to wait until tomorrow to repent, if you say, well, my sin is no big deal and I can put it off until the next day or next month or next year, and then the Lord returns. No, Jesus is saying, put away your sin now. Put it away now and believe that the kingdom of God is near. Jesus uses a very strong expression here. He is stressing the word not. He wants you to know that his word is absolute. His word will not pass away. No matter what you may think or believe or what the world will tell you, his word will come true. It came true at the manger. It came true at the cross. It came true at the empty tomb. It will come true on the great last day. So Jesus closes by saying this, be careful or your hearts will be weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and anxieties of life. And that day will close on you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon all those who live on the face of the whole earth. Be always on the watch and pray that you may be able to escape all that is about to happen and that you may be able to stand before the Son of Man. Dearest ones in Christ Jesus, don't live in the future, always planning to do better tomorrow. You know, doing that is like driving this season down a highway and never looking to your right or left. You're focused on the road, and pretty soon you'll have grilled venison. Splat, deer all over the front of your car. That's what it's like if you're living in the future. Never caring about what's to your left or to your right. Never caring about your sin. Don't fall into this world's trap of easy fixes and acceptable sins. There is no such thing as an easy fix or a sin that is acceptable to God. Never call anything good that God calls evil. Stop making excuses for your sin. God is very clear about His law, isn't He? The wages of sin is death. Dearly beloved, Jesus is coming, like it or not, believe it or not. So be ready. And my friends, you are ready. You are ready because God has made you ready. He took your sins upon Himself and nailed them to a cross. He made you ready by rising on the third day and therefore guaranteeing each of you a resurrection on that great last day. He is making you ready this very morning by serving to you His body and blood for the forgiveness of all your sin. Yes, your Lord has made you ready. In His grace and in His mercy, He is sending a son who will be born in Bethlehem as a baby. A baby that was destined to die for the whole world. And a son who certainly has forgiven you of all your sin. He has made you ready, and He is coming again. Thanks be to Jesus. Even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God that surpasses all human understanding guards your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.